Our next session today is the State of Birds. Bikram Grewal, Avinash Khemka, and Panchami Ukil on the avian life of Odisha and the need to conserve its delicate biodiversity. Panchami Ukil is a Bhubaneswar-based bird watcher and bird photographer who pioneered community bird watching in Odisha with her group, the Bhubaneswar Bird Walk. Avinash Khemka is a wildlife photographer based in Cuttack. He has been documenting the habitat of the birds of Odisha as well as the people of the Mangalajori wetlands for the last few years. Bikram Grewal is a conservationist and author with over 30 published books. He's based in Delhi. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Sukanya. It's wonderful when you have to do a session with friends, and both Panchami and Avinash and I go back a long way. So this is going to be a bit of a family banter. You know, Odisha is so rich in birds, as has been documented by earlier, mostly British ornithologists. There were birds like the forest owlet, which is now only found in one place in Maharashtra, or the great Indian bustard, of which only 50 are left. They were all found in Odisha. And despite these two birds, which are highly endangered, Odisha is possibly one of the richest states in birds. But nobody knew it. Nobody cared. There were some people who would come, but they would work as individuals, documenting in for their own needs, as it were, the avifauna of here. But luckily, and much to my particular joy, Panchami, who's sitting on my right, decided to take things in hand and formalize bird watching, formalize in quotes, bird watching in Odisha. So she formed the Bhubaneswar Bird Walks. It was a sort of loose body, but they, using the power of the net, they would send out information about bird walks. People started joining in, and now it has grown tremendously, and they are systematically reporting, writing on birds. Avinash, who comes from Cuttack, Cuttack was the home of one of India's greatest bird watchers called Colonel Samuel Tickell, about 100 years back. A.O. Hume, who is India's greatest and most well-known this thing, said that Samuel Tickell was the best bird watcher he had ever met. He wrote on birds and mammals. He was born in Cuttack. He was married at the Cuttack Church. Unfortunately, like everything else, Odisha has forgotten one of his greatest sons. We tried, Anil Dheer, and we found his wedding certificate at the church, but where he lived, nobody knows anything. And this is the state of environment in our country, which we will discuss more. But Avinash has picked up, I would say, the mantle of Samuel Tickell and run with it. He's a businessman, an unusual businessman, because he's equally interested in the Odisha's nature and has undertaken his long journey to document the richness of the avifauna and the fauna of Odisha. There are many, many places that you would have heard of but never visited. And the jewel in the crown in all of this is a wetland which is barely an hour and a half, 90 minutes away from Bhubaneswar, called Mangalajori. When I had the good fortune to be taken there by Panchami a long time back, I was amazed how good and rich that wetland was. I mean, it was a smaller version of Bharatpur, but very few, if any, knew about its very existence. Avinash then started documenting what we call the Mangalajori inheritance, and only last month, he exhibited his absolutely exquisite exhibitions in Bhubaneswar. He will now continue this for the next couple of years. We will talk about the Mangla Jodi experience, how it has helped. Panchami knows more about it than I do. But Panchami, now tell me, what made you suddenly wake up one morning and said, look, we need to get things organized here? And what was the motivation behind your starting the Bhubaneswar Bird Walks and taking it to the heights that it is today?
A very good afternoon. Namaskar. What delights me the most is that we have a session on birds in a literary festival. And we have Bikram Grewal, who is one of the foremost ornithologists, bird book authors of India, and he has been kind enough to moderate this session for us. Kala kala mukharita charu bihange, janani janani janani, bande utkala janani. So said our bard poet, Kantakavi Lakshmikanta Mahapatra, implying that the skies of our beautiful Odisha are ringing with the choirs of a myriad singing birds. So that is the natural inheritance that has been passed on to us. Why birds? There are many of you sitting here in the audience today who are from Bhubaneswar. As we talk, at this point of time, there are at least 15 to 20 species of birds around us in this very campus, or even more. But we haven't woken up to birds as much as we ought to. Ancient man called bird the sentinel species, which means that any change in environment affects birds first. So they are called the indicator species. The well-being of an ecosystem can be gauged by the number of birds in that ecosystem. Therefore, it is extremely important to document birds regularly in a habitat or in a space, whether rural space or urban space, to understand the changes that are happening in the ecosystem of that particular place.
For instance, what would you say that the sparrow is an indicator in, or the
absolutely,
loss of sparrow?
Absolutely, absolutely. In my growing up years in the 70s and the 80s, sparrows lived in our home. They co-inhabited our homes and gardens. And then suddenly, 20 years later, sparrows are completely wiped out of Bhubaneswar city. So why has that happened? We have obviously done something very wrong, for which sparrows no longer considered it safe, secure to remain in Bhubaneswar city. So when I have always been interested in birds, I grew up in a home which had a huge garden, and we had many birds coming there, like, because there were a lot of trees in that garden as well. There was a pond in the garden. And 30 years later, I noticed, apart from the sparrows, there were many other birds that we had lost. Being interested in birds, I used to follow the activities of bird watchers in other states. And in 2011, I went to Delhi to participate in a Delhi bird walk. And that is when I realized how documentation by amateur bird watchers can actually contribute extensively to bird documentation. And that led me to begin the Bhubaneswar Bird Walks in 2012, March, in Bhubaneswar. Every Sunday morning, we take nature lovers out to various habitats in and around Bhubaneswar. And we document birds in those habitats.
Would you sort of expand it a little by bringing in e-bird and the contribution of Orissa now as you...
Right. So Cornell University has a avifauna database called e-bird, which means we are documenting birds online in real time. Earlier, there was very, very little documentation of the avifauna from Orissa. It was only scientists, biologists, who in the course of their research documented birds, and they used to send in their reports to scientific magazines. But once eBird started, it opened up a new world of documentation where amateur birders began to contribute substantially to the documentation of birds. Orissa did not have any presence in eBird, but I'm proud to say that in the last 3 or 4 years, we have contributed, we are in fact one of the highest contributors to eBird in terms of photographs and bird lists, lists of birds that we are documenting.
Avinash, you are a businessman. You make and sell biscuits in a huge, huge way. Bird watching, bird photography, how did it come to you? What made you pick up your binoculars and what made you pick up your camera and decide that you're going to document the wetlands, the grasslands, the birds of Orissa? What was the spark that started all of this?
Good afternoon, everyone. So, I started photography in 2012, January, but for 10 years before that, every vacation of mine would be inevitably into forests or hills. And I would get up early in the morning, have my shoes and go out for 2-3 hours. Sometimes it so happened that I would be traveling with my family and suddenly at one place I would say, drop me here, you move on, I'll walk down, and I would walk down for 3-4 hours and reach later. So in November 2011, I was narrating the same thing to a friend of mine and he coerced me to buy a DSLR. And I was lucky enough that my first ever trip with my DSLR was to Mangalajodi. I went to Chilika, I asked the boatman over there about birds and he told me, if you want to see birds, go to Mangalajodi. And the beauty of the place, the sheer number of birds, the variety and the numbers of birds over there, it mesmerized me. And from January 2012, I have been going there again and again and again. Over a period of 6 years, I have spent around 200 nights over there. Initially, it was a hobby. Then, as I admired the beauty more and more, as I spent more and more time over there, I understood that along with this beauty, this place or every place in nature has got some utility. As mankind, we depend on water for our survival. In the same way, all the birds and animals, they also depend on water. Nature is an integral part of our survival. So it has got extreme important utility. And when I understood the utility of nature and wildlife, it came to my mind that we have to ensure continuity. So my way of ensuring continuity was to document nature and wildlife and to showcase it to people and to create awareness about nature and wildlife.
Well, that's a very laudable aim and ambition, and good luck and Godspeed in your endeavors. But, you know, we live in a country where environment is of the least importance, particularly under the current regime, because the word progress that is being touted so much is ultimately going to be the downfall of this country. You see, you can't fool around with nature. Nature has a way of coming back and biting you really hard. The way our forests are being destroyed, at the rate the forests are being destroyed, wetlands are being drained out to build buildings, concretization, grasslands is, people think that grasslands, wetlands are wastelands. They are not. They are the sustainers of your life. And And I'm sorry, Panchami, to say this, but when I travel often with you over Orissa, I see no sign of this destruction not taking place. When you go to Simlipal, if you go to Rushkulia, if you go to Bhitarkarnika, irresponsible tourism, this does not bode well for the future of Orissan or Oriya wildlife. What do you think?
Sir, I completely agree. This is just not only about Orissa, it's happening worldwide at the rate at which we are losing forests worldwide. It's a matter of great concern. Look at Bhubaneswar. You know, every monsoon we are cribbing about flooding in certain areas. Why is it happening? This rapid development, urbanization, we are simply going, closing our wetlands, and we are constructing high rises over them. So you see, there is no place for rainwater to run off, and so it's just accumulating. And that is the reason why this flooding is happening. So everything is man-made. And yet, year after year, we fail to realize and we are going on destroying our wetlands, thinking that they are wastelands, whereas wetlands nurture millions of life forms. And they are very important linkages between man and his environment. So it's the folly of mankind to not understand when things are so visible before him. And this kind of destruction is happening everywhere. I really don't know at what point we are going to understand, after how much destruction we are going to understand. But at the same time, I believe in hope. And I also believe that every single effort can make a difference. We have many heroes in the field of wildlife and conservation. There is a man in Assam who has actually created a forest single-handedly in a span of 10 years. So I believe a conservation conscience has to take root within each of us, and each of us has to try to contribute towards lessening, reducing this destruction.
You know, it's what the story you tell is not a very good one. But you're quite right, this is happening all over the world, South America, Africa. But you know, the future of this country really lies in the younger hands, in the school children. And therefore, Avinash, I was really delighted when I learned that you were planning to take your exhibition on Mangalajori to schools around Bhubaneswar. Can you just elaborate on what plans you have for the future?
When I started photography, it was just a hobby. I went all over India and outside India as well. And slowly, a seriousness came in, and this hobby turned into passion. So at one point of time, I realized that if I am deriving so much pleasure out of this natural beauty, this has to be protected. And it has to be kept in safe hands forever. That's when me and Panchami, we formed a charitable trust named Song of the Wild. And we thought of having an exhibition. Having an exhibition to showcase the beauty of the place and also to create awareness about the importance of nature and wildlife. Now we are taking this initiative to schools and colleges. We are engaging with the school students, college students, young minds of IT companies. We are conducting workshops over there. We are sensitizing them about the importance of coexistence. For me, like, if there is a bush and somebody wants to clear it out to make it a plain ground. I look at a bush as a home for some insects and a home for some birds, small birds maybe. Someday someone will come with a bulldozer to smash my home and kill me or kick me out. How will I feel? In the same way, that insect or that bird, if it's killed or kicked out of that bush, it must feel the same way. So this is what I want the next generation to understand, that animals, birds, marine species, and insects, they have an equal right on this earth.
Well, we are talking about gloom and doom. Let's now change the trend slightly to the more hopeful, as they say. Panchami, do you see what are the things? Almost every state has a bird festival.
We have one too.
Where?
So we have been having, the government of Orissa and Orissa Tourism, if I'm not mistaken, have been holding a Chilika Bird Festival for the last 2 years. Actually, they started last year. They have another one this year. But talking of bird festivals, I'd like to mention that Orissa's biodiversity surpasses the biodiversity of many states in India.
Oh, without doubt. Without doubt,
absolutely. In spite of that, we have not given our biodiversity its due in terms of showcasing it to others, in terms of protecting it, and of course, in terms of the scope of ecotourism. I represented Odisha in two bird festivals which were organized by the government of Uttar Pradesh at Chambal about 3 years ago. If you look at Orissa, the birds in Orissa, in terms of species, in terms of numbers, are way, way, way beyond the birds that we see in Uttar Pradesh. Yet, the scale at which the initiative was taken up by the Uttar Pradesh government to introduce or to highlight bird tourism or to attract bird tourism in the state, when I look at Orissa and the way we have organized our bird festival in the last 2 years, I'm extremely disappointed. I believe with the kind of biodiversity, the kind of birds, the kind of bird habitats that we have to showcase, we should take it to a much more professional level. We need to talk about the richness of our birds. It's just one video film on television is not going to work. We need to engage more people. We need to engage more stakeholders into conservation through these kind of events. And I wish we could do it at a much more elevated level than what we are doing today.
You know, it's a it's an interesting concept, bird fest. The more bird tourism you come, the more employee you generate. And local people, it's not like a big hotel coming in and bringing in the staff from outside and getting the taxi wallahs from outside. This provides employment to the locals. We will talk in slight more detail about the Mangalajodi experience. But it was a place where huge amount of poaching used to take place. Thanks to the efforts, but I'll let Panchami elaborate on it.
Yeah.
That has almost come to an end, and the poachers are now gamekeepers because they are stakeholders in the business. So Panchami, can you just sort of...
So I just mentioned one person who made a difference in conservation from Assam. We have our own wildlife heroes in our state. Mangalajodi is a classic example. One man, 25 years ago, Mr. Nanda Kishore Bhujbal, who is a resident of Tangi, he realized that every year, lakhs of birds were being killed in Mangalajodi and Chilika area. And the villagers were killing them, and they were selling them, they were also eating them, and that was a means of their livelihood. So he took it upon himself to try and educate these villagers to stop killing birds. It took him 3 or 4 long years, but after that, he managed. And Mangalajodi, I would say, is one of the greatest conservation stories of the world. But we, as Odias, are always very laid back when it comes to talking about our successes. And therefore, it has not probably been highlighted as much as the Amur Falcon story of Nagaland or many other conservation stories that have gained name and fame in India. Anyway, so after Mr. Bhujbal coaxed the villagers to stop killing birds, he also ensured alternate means of employment for them, alternate livelihoods, so to say. And these villagers were trained as bird guides so that they could take people around in their boats in winter, in the migratory season, and help people to identify birds and also earn the livelihood through this. But then when one man initiates a movement, we need more stakeholders to carry it forward, you know, for generations. Unfortunately, there was a lull and poaching re-happened in Mangalajodi, after which the government and NGOs joined hands with Mr. Bhujbal's organization. And today, we are very, very proud to say that Mangalajodi is completely free from bird poaching. So this is a very inspiring conservation story from our own state. And I believe with the right kind of interest, it can be replicated in many other habitats in Orissa and elsewhere.
Well, I mean, this, I agree with you completely. It is one of the greatest conservation stories. And with the kind of work that people like Avinash are doing and you are doing, for every Mangalajodi, there must be another 100 Mangalajodis, which
Absolutely.
Are probably lying on this. But as it is, you have big places like Simlipal or Chandaka or Satgoshia and all these other places. They are in abysmal states. Now, as an NGO, you can only do a little bit, but it is actually the work of the government, of the Forest Department, who have the resources, who have the power to do that. And that, unfortunately, is not a malaise that is peculiar to Orissa only. It's there all over the world. Now, we have to use, what are the tools we have? We have Avinash's magical photographs. We have Panchami's prose. It's a very strong team, but they have to earn their livelihood. So they can't take off, you know, and go to schools on a daily basis and talk to children. So what is the solution? The solution is that people who are being paid to do this must do it. And with the aid and abetment and help of people such as these two, is there anything like that happening?
Sir, as I keep saying that, you know, there is this new term called citizen scientists. And somebody like Avinash Khemka, who spent 5 years giving his time and energy to Mangalajodi, because he realized that it's not being documented in the way it should have been. So he's invested almost a crore of rupees in photography equipment over the last 5 years so that he is able to document each and every minute detail about that habitat. So you see, the intent is that serious, the passion is that intense. I believe that a citizen scientist like him and many others who are working selflessly because they don't earn anything out of it. But these are the people who are observing minute details. They know much more than what a Forest Department person who's just doing his duty. He is not even bothered whether we are seeing a lack of birds this year and we are seeing only 10,000 next year. But he is documenting it all, and there are many like him, who are making these small observations and documenting them very sincerely. I believe that these stakeholders have to be taken into confidence when policies on environment, when policies on ecotourism, on conservation are being framed by the government. And I'm very disappointed that so far in Orissa, we have not seen that happen as yet.
Well, I disagree with one thing when you say that the Forest Department is doing their duty. To me, that is not duty. It is actually not doing their duty.
Absolutely.
Because they should use people like Avinash and yourselves. You can, I mean, and take all the credit. You will you happily give, you'll give
me,
to
absolutely,
them.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But, you know, where is it? Why is there no book on the birds of Orissa? Why is there absolutely, even people who are coming to Orissa for wildlife are going to the Olive Ridley breeding. And even there, there is rampant, you know, hotels are coming up, disturbing dogs on the beach, eating the babies. I mean, it's carnage. And here you have such beautiful places. And nothing, I mean, there's an amazing story, sir. I mean, I'll tell you. The rarest pigeon in India is called the pale-capped pigeon.
Sir, it's one of the rarest pigeons in the world.
In the world.
On the verge of extinction.
I've been a bird watcher for 60 years. I saw my one when I was... You know, 60 years, after 60 years. And where do I see it? I see it in the heart of Bhubaneswar. In the Ekambra Kanan.
Ekambra Kanan, Nayapalli.
Nayapalli, we're going for a walk. She had seen it before and she tells me and I said, come on, this is, I'm not believing it till I see it. And sure enough, they're there. That one event in any other country or state would have turned tourism around. There. Countries in Bolivia and other places, Southeast Asia, whose economies run on wildlife tourism. Entire of Africa is an example of that. But despite all the noise we made, some people came. This is where it should be the state bird.
We requested for that, sir. Like we have, like about 3 years ago when we saw this flock of pale-capped pigeons, Columba Punisia, in Ekambra Kanan during one of our scheduled Sunday morning bird walks. After that, we have put in a request with the Chief Minister of Orissa to please consider having the pale-capped pigeon as the state bird of Orissa. Why are we asking for the status of a state bird? What happens is that when you focus on a vulnerable species that's on the on the verge of extinction, you take more measures for its conservation. It's not just about having a beautiful bird as a state bird. There is a reason. There's a reason behind this. And we, as passionate bird lovers, we don't want to see another species, you know, going out of extinction. As we are talking now, the great Indian bustard is on the verge of extinction. I don't know, 5 years later, if we are going to see a great Indian bustard in India anymore.
You certainly will not. There are only about 50 left.
Absolutely. So that's the reason we wanted... the pale-capped pigeon to be the state bird of Orissa so that it garners adequate attention of all stakeholders and some steps are taken towards conservation of its habitat. Unfortunately, that's not happened as yet.
So it doesn't bode well. There's hope people like Avinash and you are there still. But we have to notch this up to a higher level. And it's too much of me to ask you to carry on the mantle single-handedly. So we have to think, we have to besiege the government, we have to besiege the Forest Department to step up their act. You are sitting on a gold mine, not only physical geographic gold mine, but a natural history gold mine. Like I told you, Orissa's greatest son, Samuel Tickle, we don't even know where his house is. Nobody's interested. The Orissa has forgotten him. You have a jewel in your hands, and you're not bothered about it. So, we have 5 or 10 minutes. Is there anything else that you would like to add? We'll ask some questions later. But Avinash, just now, you have done Mangala Jyoti for 5 years. Are you going to shift attention to, let's say, Beta Karnika? I know it's too much to ask you as an individual.
That's exactly what me and Panchami want to do. During the exhibition, I decided that I will no more go out of Orissa for photography. I'll dedicate all my available time in Orissa. And exhibition is a 7-day affair. And after that, what? So we have decided that 2019 December, we will come up with a coffee table book on Mangala Jyoti. And then I will shift my entire attention and my resources and my efforts to Bhitar Kanika, so that I can come up with a photo exhibition on Bhitar Kanika in 2020 December and a coffee table book on Bhitar Kanika in 2021 December. Every alternate year, a photo exhibition on any forest of Orissa, and every alternate year, a coffee table book on that place, so that people within Orissa and outside Orissa, entire world, all over, people come to know about the natural beauty of different forests of Orissa. This is one part of it. And then we'll keep on engaging, as I said earlier, with the school students, with the college students, and the young minds of IT companies, sensitizing them about the importance of nature, about the importance of coexistence of wildlife, so that we can ensure that whatever is there remaining, it remains and even it improves in future. So that we hand over Mother Earth to safer hands than what we have.
Well, best of luck in your endeavors. I mean, things are as they are going. But you know, more and more people are coming to realize that the environment is under great threat. I mean, my friend Malvika organizes this Lit Fest, so readily agreed to a session which is non-literary in the strictest sense of the word. And because she realized that, you know, people are getting more and more truly worried about the future. The rate we are losing, the next war is not going to be fought between India and Pakistan. It is going to be fought between America and Canada, because Canada has all the ice and water and America has drought. It is that serious. If you go, water riots is the biggest thing now. People are rioting over water. In Cherrapunji, which has the largest rainfall in the world, a half a bucket of potable water costs 50 rupees. Because you have denuded the forest, there is no soakage. The water runs down the hillsides, joins the river, and gone. This is it. Look at it. For the first time, you had floods in Ladakh. Bombay, 500 people died. 600 people died in the city of Madras. Because you started damming the rivers, you started blocking the natural flow, you uprooted the trees. In Bhubaneswar, where I come so often, the rains is a disaster here. So people are getting interested, particularly children. When I go and speak to children, which I do all the time, they ask the smartest questions, and everybody says, what can we do? Well, you can start by telling your parents that, you know, we don't need a huge car. We can easily travel in a Maruti Swift or whatever. You don't need to put on your air conditioners 1 hour in advance to cool yourself. Come on. When we were growing up, there were no air conditioners. You can start by saving water in the smallest way. Instead of having a shower, have a bucket bath. It's much nicer. And so these are the small things that you can do. And like I said, it's all the young people here who have to carry it forward. Our time is running up, so if there are one or two questions, yes? Yeah, Sukanya, can you give a map, a mic? One by one.
Good morning.
Good morning, Devashish. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sorry. I have three questions, one for Panchami ma'am, one for the moderator, Bikram sir, and one for Avinash, if I'm permitted.
Yeah, yes, yeah, yeah.
The question to Panchami ma'am is, have you looked at, instead of, let's not rely on the government. I really always think that they're extremely constant when it comes to technical help.
Yeah.
And they require a lot of technical inputs, and
right.
They will not say they require.
Right.
So do you think that a research project or a, foreign research project on the pigeon which you're working,
yeah,
and abstract would,
yes,
actually put it also on the literary fest of all the throughout the country, and will be able to contribute to that idea of much better than just giving it a state bird status?
Devashish, we've already done a paper in Indian Birds Journal and also in a scientific journal which is published from the United States. Shweta,
okay,
Shri Purohit, one of our very bright young bird watchers, and she's pursuing her PhD in the Central University in Koraput. She has authored this paper, and
okay,
I'm a co-author. So we have already put it in the scientific domain. We tried 3 years back, we wrote to the government, but we didn't receive any response, and we didn't know how to further go about it. But in the meantime, we have been doing our homework, and we have already published two papers on the pale cap pigeon.
So probably a book from you would do.
Hope to.
Yeah.
For the moderator, sir. So when we talk about the younger generation, the only thing which comes to their mind, and probably to my kids' mind, would be Angry Birds. The game which they play, unfortunately, at times. So, is there any way of having, nature champions or, bird champions in schools? What is your thought on that? Have you done it anywhere,
yes,
else in the country?
Yes. I spend my time, or as much time I can spare, talking to children. And I disagree with you when you say that it's only Angry Birds or, mobile phones and all. Of course, that's a big part of it. But I find that there is much more enthusiasm in the children than jaded people such as myself. And therefore, I keep insisting. We keep insisting that that the future lies in this hand. Now, when I go to schools, we have a small program called Kids for Tigers, which we are now expanding to include birds and habitat and all that. We have 10 million members of it. But again, like everybody else, we are limited by money. Even a wildlife magazine, which I'm involved, called Cub, we have no advertising. People will pay millions to advertise Coca-Cola and all that. But regardless of that, for 15 years, we have not missed an issue. And by the same token, we have not made any money on it. So we are striving on that. Kids love it. But we get no help from either business houses or from the government, certainly not. It's only the goodwill and the kindness of strangers such as yourself that we manage to survive. So while I disagree with you that there's very little enthusiasm in children, I do agree with you on the fact that the future is very dismal.
To Avinash, when you were doing documentation on Mangala Jodi and going forward with Bitarkanika, have you thought of taking a group of enthusiastic children from different schools whom you can also teach the nuances of photography with maybe a smaller camera which they can afford or can carry, and make them get into Instagram to talk about it in the new mediums, to talk about it, so that your whole idea of projecting it moves beyond the coffee table, which is very restricted to the elite world.
This is exact
video you're making,
this is exactly what me and Panchami are trying to do. we brought in students from 12 schools to my exhibition, and then we discussed with the school authorities and we declared essay writing competitions in the schools and painting sketching competitions.
On
Mangla Jodi. This 1 year will be on Mangla Jodi, then again 2 years on Bhitarkanika, and then 2 years maybe on Satkosia, Simlipal, Kuldiha, all those places. So we will go to the schools, we will have printed literature with us, with text and pictorials. We'll distribute it amongst the kids. We'll have a talk or a workshop. We'll give an audiovisual presentation. And after some days, we will have essay writing competitions so that we understand what the kids have learned from the audiovisual presentation, from the workshop, from the literature that we have distributed. We'll also have drawing, sketching, painting competitions. We will take the winners to Mangla Jodi at our cost. We will also request the school authorities to have a study tour or a school picnic to that place, led by us, arranged by us. This year, me and a friend of mine who is sitting here, Ravin, we are also making a video documentary on Mangla Jodi. So from July till now, we have spent at least 30-35 days over there, and this will continue till September or October 2019. In the coming 8-9 months, we will be spending another minimum 50 nights over there. Try to capture the beauty of the place, try to capture the number of species over there, and the village life of that place, the habitat, ecology of the place. Because I believe, like in our exhibition, the name was The Magic of Mangla Jodi, Inheritance, Ecology, Conservation. We have inherited this nature and wildlife, and it's a wonderful ecology. Our survival also depends on it, and it's our foremost duty to do whatever possible for its conservation.
I'd just like to add a little bit here. Devashish, when we're talking about children, do you understand the role that parents have to play? It's a Sunday morning here in the Lit Fest, with the itinerary having been circulated for many, many days now. They know that there's a session on birds. But do you see any parents with children today? It's a Sunday morning, it's a holiday. They should have prioritized and they should have brought the children here. It's a beautiful outdoor ambience, which, you know, Tata Lit Fest does every year. I always compliment them. So if as parents we keep our children cooped up inside, you know, let them, allow them to be lazy on a Sunday morning, or, you know, force them to go for tuitions or to play cricket, but if there's a session happening on nature and environment, we are not bothered, then, I mean, like, what is the way forward? How do we, you know, engage children? So, you know, that's a huge cause of concern for me. So, I mean, I run a school, and I would love to call my school a green school, because we are, you know, like, doing our best to imbibe green ethics in children. And the foremost thing that I tell parents is that you have 50% responsibility to carry out what I'm teaching the children in school. So, you know, I believe parents have a much bigger role to play. It's not just about Avinash, Bikram sir, and me. You know, we need parents to be equal stakeholders in the process of conservation. And for that, they have to allow the children to go outdoors, to love the outdoors, to love birds, to love animals, to love the forests. And, you know, I would also like to mention that as parents, Avinash and his wife take their children every vacation, you know, to a forest. So that is the role that parents have to play.
Well, I'm sorry about gloom and doom. Yes, we can take one or two more questions. We have about 5 minutes. Is that right, Sukanya? 5 minutes?
No, he will speak in Odia, so you'll have to answer.
Yeah, yeah. I
have one or two questions.
Yeah, first you, sir, then we'll come to him.
Yes,
sir, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Present state part of...
We can't hear. The mic is not working.
Oh, yes, yes. The present state bird of Odisha is Indian roller.
Bahut bahut badhiya.
Then why you suggest that a different pigeon for state bird? This bird, Indian roller, that is Caracasia striatus, is a very dangerous species. Have you studied about that bird?
Yes, sir.
And have you suggested any conservational aspects to the government to restore the bird? You see, that bird is very, very endangered. Another question is that how many migratory birds in Mangala Jodi you have documented?
Just
one more question.
Yeah.
The details of Indian birds,
yes,
are found in the Birds of India, that is Ornithology by Dr. Salim Ali, from Bombay Natural History, he is no more. He has documented almost all birds of the Indian territory. Besides that, the Zoological Survey of India, you must have heard the name.
Yes.
The Zoological Survey of India has a bird section.
Yes.
They have documented all the species of Orissa. So, learned and ornithologists who are working on this aspect, I want to suggest them, you must consult the bird section or ornithological section of Zoological Survey of India. You will get every information about bird. You see, bird is the very beautiful creature of the nature among all animals. Thank you.
Sir, to answer, you asked me several questions. Let me start with the state bird of Orissa, which is the Indian roller, like you so correctly said. It is under threat, like every other bird is under threat. But the reason we suggested the pale-capped pigeon is because of its rarity. The Indian roller is killed for religious purposes. I am fully aware of that. But the pale-capped pigeon is a bird that if you are lucky, you will see it once in a lifetime. And Orissa has it. The roller is already seven states now because of the split in Andhra Pradesh. Yes. So nobody's denigrating that, but it is for the conservancy of and the future of the pale-capped pigeon is why we suggested. To answer your second question about Salim Ali, who has documented the BNHS and the ZSI, remain very big repositories of knowledge. Unfortunately, it has not kept pace. Salim Ali documented what he saw. It was almost a single man industry. Now, in Bhubaneswar, we have 50 pairs of eyes every weekend. New birds are being discovered. It's not that they're new to science. They were there. Nobody observed them. It's purely because the number of photographers, bird watchers, binoculars have gone up so much. So while we cannot live without the information that is already being held by the BNHS or the ZSI, citizen science, as she was saying, is now playing a much bigger role in that. Yeah, is there any other question? Yes, last question. No. He's going to be difficult.
Hello. Ayam, got a question. Oje, a kukuta da kon tak bar mil jao jo poultry. Poultry a bar kon difference. Tak bar bar ast kati wale kai kwa oche. Ek number two, a Bhubaneswar gote jaga jo tu gote kosla khai pan chodi rau chale. Ye ji kosla ka sab bahut chala, tak kati kuti gote dale. Bahut kai kosla khai chodi sab rau chanti. Ala apan kala
Many people don't know who is Mangala Jodi.
ସବୁ ନେପାଳରୁ ଆସିଛି। ନେପାଳରେ ମଙ୍ଗଳା ଯେଉଁ ଚଳି ଅଛି ସେ ବଜାରରେ କାଟିକି ବିକି ଖାଉଛନ୍ତି। ତ ଚଳେଇ ନା ହୁଏ ଫୁଡ଼, ଆପଣ ତାକୁ କ'ଣ କରିବେ? ଶାଗୁଣା ଶାଗୁଣାରେ ସବୁ ଗଭର୍ଣ୍ଣମେଣ୍ଟ କହୁଛି ସେଠି ବିଲ୍ଡିଂ କରିବ, କାହିଁକି କୋଚଲା କାହିଁକି କଲେ କୋଚଲା କାହିଁ ଭାଇ ମାନେ ଦାମ ଚଳେ।
ସାର୍ ଆମେ ସେଇ ବିଷୟରେ ହିଁ ଆଜି ଇନଫ୍ୟାକ୍ଟ କଥା ହେଉଛୁ ଯେ ଆମେ
ଭୁବନେଶ୍ୱରରେ ଭଦ୍ରକ ଅଛନ୍ତି, ଓଲ୍ଡ ଟାଉନରେ ସେ ବହୁତ ଚଢ଼େଇ ଘରେ ରଖିଛନ୍ତି, କିଣିକା ରଖିଛନ୍ତି, ଘରେ ସଜେଇଛନ୍ତି। ସେ ଚଢ଼େଇ ସବୁ କ୍ୟାପ୍ଟିଭ ଚଢ଼େଇ,
କ୍ୟାପ୍ଟିଭ ଚଢ଼େଇ
ଯେଉଁ ଚଢ଼େଇ ଦେଖୁଛନ୍ତି ଅଣା ଧୋଡ଼ିରେ ସବୁ ଆସୁଛନ୍ତି। ଓଡ଼ିଶା ମାଗ୍ରେଟ୍ରେ ବାଟ ଓଡ଼ିଶା ବାଟ ଓଡ଼ିଶା ବାଟ ଡକ୍ଟର ସରିନ୍ କହିଲେ ତାଙ୍କ ଜଣେ ବନ୍ଧୁ ଅଛନ୍ତି ରୟାଲ ଫ୍ୟାମିଲିର, ମନେ ପଡ଼େ ନାଁଟା
ୟୁଏନ ଦେବ, ଡକ୍ଟର ୟୁଏନ ଦେବ
ଦେବ ଆଜ୍ଞା ଦେବ, ସେ ବହୁତ ଜିନିଷ ଦେଖିଛନ୍ତି
ଆଜ୍ଞା।
ତାଙ୍କ ବିଷୟରେ ଆପଣ କିଛି କହୁନା
ବୋଲ
ସାର୍। ଏଇଟା ହିଁ ଆମେ କହିବାକୁ ଚାହୁଁଥିଲୁ ଯେତେବେଳେ ବିକ୍ରମ ସାର୍ କହିଲେ କି 50ରୁ ଅଧିକା ପେୟାର ଅଫ୍ ଆଇଜ୍ ଆଜିକା ଦିନରେ ଅଛି ଭୁବନେଶ୍ୱରରେ, ଆଣ୍ଡ 50 କ'ଣ ସେଇଟା ଡେଫିନେଟଲି 200ରୁ ଅଧିକା ଲୋକ ଅଛନ୍ତି ଭୁବନେଶ୍ୱରରେ ଯେଉଁମାନେ କି ପ୍ରତ୍ୟେକ ଛୁଟି ଦିନ ରବିବାର ଦିନ ସକାଳେ ଉଠିକି ସେମାନେ ତାଙ୍କର ବାଇନାକୁଲର୍ସ ଧରିକି କିମ୍ବା କ୍ୟାମେରା ଧରିକି ଯାଆନ୍ତି, ଇଣ୍ଟେରିୟର୍ସକୁ ଯାଆନ୍ତି, ପ୍ରତ୍ୟେକ ବାର୍ଡ଼କୁ ଫଟୋଗ୍ରାଫି କରନ୍ତି। ଆଜି ବାୟା ବିଭର ଆପଣ ଯେଉଁଟା କହିଲେ ତା'ର ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ା ଫଟୋଜ୍ ଆପଣ ପାଇବେ ଯେଉଁଟାକି ଲୋକମାନେ ନିଜ ପଇସା ଖର୍ଚ୍ଚ କରିକି ବୁଲି ବାଲିକି ଉଠେଇକି ସୋସିଆଲ ମିଡ଼ିଆରେ ଅପଲୋଡ଼ କରୁଛନ୍ତି, ବିଭିନ୍ନ ଜାଗାରେ ତାକୁ ଦେଖାଉଛନ୍ତି। ଆମେ ମଙ୍ଗଳାଯୋଡ଼ି ବିଷୟରେ ଏଥିପାଇଁ କହୁଛୁ ସାର୍ କି ସେଇଠି ଖାଲି ମାଇଗ୍ରେଟରୀ ସ୍ପିସିଜ୍ ନାହାନ୍ତି, ମଙ୍ଗଳାଯୋଡ଼ିରେ 25-25 ସ୍ପିସିଜ୍ର ରେସିଡେଣ୍ଟ ବାର୍ଡ଼ସ୍ ମଧ୍ୟ ଅଛନ୍ତି। ମଙ୍ଗଳାଯୋଡ଼ି ଇଜ୍ ଇନ୍ ମାଇ ଓପିନିଅନ୍ ଦ କ୍ରାଉନ୍ ଜୁଏଲ୍ ଅଫ୍ ବର୍ଡିଂ ଇନ୍ ଓରିଶା, କିନ୍ତୁ ୟା ମାନେ ନୁହେଁ ଯେ ଅନ୍ୟ ଜାଗାରେ ନାହାନ୍ତି। କୁଲଡିହା, କୁଲଡିହାରେ ବହୁତ ସ୍ପିସିଜ୍ ଅଫ୍ ବାର୍ଡ଼ସ୍ ଅଛନ୍ତି। ଭିତରକାନିକା, ଭିତରକାନିକାରେ ବ୍ରାଉନ୍ ୱିଙ୍ଗ କିଙ୍ଗଫିସର ଗୋଟେ ପକ୍ଷୀ, ମ୍ୟାଙ୍ଗ୍ରୋଭ୍ ପିଟା ଗୋଟେ ବହୁତ ଇମ୍ପୋର୍ଟାଣ୍ଟ ସ୍ପିସିଜ୍, ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଏ ଭେରି ଇମ୍ପୋର୍ଟାଣ୍ଟ ସ୍ପିସିଜ୍ ଅଫ୍ ବାର୍ଡ଼।
I'm afraid we have run out completely out of time, but we are available downstairs, so if there's any other questions we'll be happy to answer it. Thank you Malvika, thank you Sukanya, thank you Purna for allowing us a session on birds in this, and for this august company that come to listen to us, thank you very very much indeed.